You are listening to the Nirvana Podcast, Episode 5, Tour Like It's 1989. Hello everybody and welcome to the Nirvana Podcast. My name is Sietse.
And I'm Yiditja.
And what we do here is every episode we take a dive in the history and or music of the great band Nirvana.
Yes, we certainly do.
Yeah, and what we did in the first episodes is first we talked about the childhood of Kurt Cobain and Chris Novoselic, the founders of Nirvana. Then we discussed the early days of the band, and in the previous two episodes we talked about side A and side B of their debut album called Bleach.
Yep. Yeah,
and we had a lot of fun with that, and I discovered quite a lot of new things about the album.
Well, definitely.
And today we're going to talk about everything that happened after they finished recording that album.
Yes,
so that's basically the whole of 1989. But before we're going to do so, I'd like to give a little shout out to Mr. Nick Soulsby. He's the founder of the website nirvanalegacy.com.
Yep.
And also a writer of two very interesting books.
Yep, great
about
books.
Nirvana. Cobain on Cobain.
Yep, interviews.
Yeah, interviews, lesser known interviews with Kurt. And also I found my friend's oral history of Nirvana.
Yep.
It's been a while since I've read that one.
Yeah. Well, basically it's about Nirvana and Kurt Cobain through interviews with other people. So it's a compilation of interview quotes.
Yeah, like fellow bands and stuff like that.
Exactly, family, stuff like that. So it gives a really nice insight from an outsider's perspective.
Yeah, it was great. And also, Nick Soulsby was kind enough to mention our podcast on his website and on his Twitter feed. So I'd like to return the favor.
Yeah.
By the way, this is also an interesting turning point, I think. In the earlier episodes, we talked about that there's a little source material to go by. Basically, it's mostly the biographies Come As You Are or Heavier Than Heaven.
Yep.
But around this time, more is being documented.
Yep.
For a part that has to do with the fact that Sub Pop, Nirvana's record label at the time, they were pretty keen on having a good PR system, even though they didn't have a lot of money to spend.
No, they basically their marketing in those first months or maybe years was maybe better even than their managing.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. They made the best of it. They at one point early in the year they flew in a British journalist, going by the name of Everett True.
Yep.
He's another person who wrote an interesting book about Nirvana. He's a bit of a typical guy, I have the feeling. But he gave him a lot of publicity. He wrote the book Nirvana, The True Story, I think.
Yeah,
it's called.
I think so. Yeah.
Or at least another biography. And yeah, a lot of people who met with the band or saw them do anything or shook hands with them, they either wrote a book themselves or they show up in other people's books.
Exactly, yeah. From this moment on, there's a lot more documentation. And
before we dive into 1989 and everything that happened, I'd like to invite everybody to go to our Facebook page, which is facebook.com/Nirvana Podcast. And maybe like us.
Yep.
And then you'll stay up to date. We let you know if there's a new episode of the podcast out, but we also sometimes share some extra footage or images or
stuff
whatever
we talked about, and we want to show there in full. So if you enjoy listening to the podcast, please go there and like us, because it's a nice way for us to also see that you care.
Yeah. Absolutely. Also, it's a convenient way of reaching out to us because you can send us a message if you don't like Facebook for some reason. And maybe there's good reasons not to like Facebook. You can also send us an email, and then you can send it to surewoodpodcast@gmail.com. The pretty bizarre email address for this podcast is surewoodpodcast@gmail.com. So if you don't like Facebook, turn to Google to reach out to us.
And if you want to know why that's our email address, just go back to the first episode and we'll explain it to you.
Yeah, right. So now let's get to it. The year 1989 for Nirvana started with them finishing the Bleach sessions.
Yep.
So they recorded the last stuff for the album.
Yep. Although the album didn't get released until June, so yeah. It was a long time between that.
Yeah, and that was pretty inconvenient because right after they finished recording the album, they hit the road.
Yep.
So they did quite a lot of gigs and performances. Not as a three-piece, but as a four-piece, because
yes.
Joining the band at that moment was Mr. Jason Everman. His name came up before because you can also see his picture on the front cover of Bleach.
Yep.
He's the guy with the long curly hair.
Exactly. And if you have the original version of the album, then his name will be on there as well.
Yeah.
Even though he didn't play on it.
No, but he did pay for the album.
Yes.
And also they wanted to make him feel at home in the band because
yep.
he was there for only a couple of months. But those were the months in which the artwork and stuff was prepared. So,
exactly. Yep.
So that's what happened.
And basically, Kurt wanted to have like an extra guitar player in the band because he felt that there was more room needed for the guitar parts because he was starting to write like more elaborate music, and he felt that by just having one guitarist himself, they couldn't do everything live.
Yeah.
So he wanted an extra person there.
Yeah, it kind of makes sense.
Yep.
One of the Sub Pop guys, he noted that they had a massive sound going
yep.
on, the three of them, but then Kurt was, when he played a solo, then of course the rhythm guitar parts,
exactly,
well, they fell away, so
yep.
Then it was a lot thinner sounding.
Yep.
So it kind of makes sense to have an extra guitar player on. Let's have a listen to how it sounded.
Yep.
We're going to a live performance from that period. So you can also hear Jason Everman play, and they're playing the song Blandest. So here's a small piece of that. Yeah, that's about enough, I think, to get an impression. The audio quality isn't great.
No, but you still get a feel for how they sounded, and you can definitely hear that wall of sound is there for the live performance. So that's good.
Yeah, and also I wanted to throw in this song because we mentioned it before.
Yep.
They recorded it as a possible B-side for the first single, but then discarded it. We haven't played this song in the podcast just yet.
Nope.
So I thought it was a nice variation. There's very little live versions of this one.
Yep.
This might even be the only one. I'm not
100%
sure. Anyway, that's basically what they sounded like, the four of them, which isn't too bad, but the tour wasn't a big success.
No. But that was logical because nobody really knew them at that moment. They had the single out, but the album wasn't there yet. Single was pressed in like a low quantity, so not a lot of people had heard of them. So it's hard to get people to the shows. I think they opened for Mudhoney on that tour, who were a bit more known, but also still at the start of their career. So, and there was also, I think, a lot of problems with, like, on the technical side, often.
Yeah.
That's something that comes back throughout the entire touring year, I think. So it wasn't ideal.
Yeah, like I said, sometimes gigs would get canceled because nobody showed up. Or hardly anybody,
yep.
or just a handful of people. I think they sometimes opened up for
yep.
Mudhoney,
not,
but not
every
always.
Time. No.
They played really small rooms, and it just didn't really work out. I think they were disappointed as well because,
yep.
well, they had just made an album.
Yep.
And then they thought they would, you know, step up a bit.
Exactly.
But that didn't really happen.
No.
Also, the dynamics within the band didn't really work out.
No.
And I'm not sure if they felt that Jason Everman was a good enough guitar player.
No.
There's this quote from one of the technical guys who said, I heard two guitar sounds coming in and only Kurt Cobain's guitar made sense. So I put that one way up, and then Jason's was really low in the mix.
I can imagine that it must have been hard for him coming in at that moment, because they just started like to find their form as a threesome. Because he hadn't played with them in the studio, I mean, playing live with them, probably with not a lot of rehearsals, and then under circumstances like this, I can imagine that it wasn't easy for him.
No.
And also there's all of these weird stories about how they sort of sabotaged their own gigs as well, which makes sense, because if you don't have an audience, then you start doing weird stuff.
Yeah.
And
you get tired of touring and
exactly.
being in a van, and you know,
yeah,
you get bored.
You get bored, you get annoyed, you start drinking too much and do weird stuff on stage. I really like all of those stories that, like, it sometimes feels that Nirvana during this period especially was not just a band but also like a circus act. Because there's so many mentions of like Kurt playing his guitar while standing on his head.
Yeah, there's a picture of that.
Exactly.
Picture,
and like Chris throwing his bass guitar in the air and then catching it or not catching it.
Yeah, that's so, true.
Lots of those things going on.
Well, they weren't afraid of a bit of showmanship.
No.
I mean, there's stuff
you have
like
to do something if people don't
and
really pay attention to you.
Yeah, and
makes sense.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
So in a way, they were growing as a live act as well, I think, because they were experimenting.
Yeah.
And see what worked and what didn't work. A lot of times, it felt that they were out of control, and they probably were. So they were like searching for the balance between having a good stage performance and, you know, drawing the attention and being out of control and destructive. And
exactly.
Something like that. So yeah, it must be hard to be the fourth member coming in.
Yep.
And I think another problem was that Jason Everman, he was really big into speed metal.
Yep.
And Nirvana, in the beginning, they sounded a lot more metal-like.
Yep.
Yeah. We just discussed the Bleach album. There's a lot of metal-sounding stuff on it. And Jason had been in a band before with Chad Channing, the drummer of the time. And I think they both liked metal a lot. And they've played metal together in their former band. And that was not the direction Kurt and Chris wanted to go.
No. So there was a division in there as well.
Yeah. But still, Jason stayed with the band long enough to join them for one recording session.
Yes.
Which was a weird recording session because they were asked to perform a song of the band Kiss.
Yep.
I suppose everybody knows the band Kiss.
Yeah.
Or at least knows the song I Was Made for Loving You.
Exactly. I think that most people have a hard time mentioning any other Kiss song after that.
Well, I know the song Do You Love Me?
Yes.
Because that's the song that Nirvana got to do for a compilation album.
Yep.
Where underground punk rock grunge band were asked to, I don't know who came up with the idea, but
no,
there was a session.
Yeah, there
was
a session.
And there was an album.
Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of contemporary bands and colleagues of Nirvana who are on that album with Kiss covers.
Yeah,
and
even the Melvins. There.
Yeah, Melvins are on there.
Yeah. Okay, so let's listen to what they played. They played Do You Love Me? You really like my limousine. You like the way the wheels roll. You like the seven-inch leather heels and going to all of the shows. Bye!
I like how, like, when that song starts, you think, oh, this could be, yeah, Nirvana, I get it. And then when the melody of the song really kicks in, then you're like, no, this is something entirely different. And they haven't changed it that much from how it sounded.
That's
so
right.
So it's basically, I mean, it's a nice cover, but it's not really interesting. Like they did later on with covers.
That's true, but I think that's mostly because they didn't take it very seriously,
yeah.
and they were having fun with it, and
yep.
you know, Kurtz is singing pretty ironically because, well,
yes.
they were like the anti-Kiss, you know, I mean, like being
yep.
a cool rock act, I mean,
exactly.
that didn't fit them at all. So
no, they
fun
were
with it.
Exactly, and they were. It's a nice contrast because they were described during that period, especially when you get back to those journalists from the UK who famously wrote about Nirvana, saying like these are like really normal people, and
yeah.
and you can see if they're not playing music, they have like
they would fix your car.
Exactly.
That quote, yeah.
And like Kiss with their like stage attitude and their exuberant
yeah.
outfits and face paint and fireworks
yeah.
is exactly the opposite of what Nirvana is.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a weird little thing they did.
Yep.
It's fun that it exists at
yep.
least. Yeah. And like I said, it's like a historical document for Jason Everman. So you can hear him play on this song and on the song called Dive
yep.
Which later was released as a B-side for the Sliver single, and it's also on the Incesticide collection.
Yeah, so we'll get to that later on. But they recorded it at the same time, which
yeah.
makes sense. I mean, they probably had a bit more studio time, so yeah.
Yeah, and the guy who produced them, he also said that they weren't working that seriously on Do You Love Me, but they put in a bit more effort when they were recording their own song,
yep.
Dive. So that
makes sense.
And after that, they went on tour again. I think it was like a college tour, and
yep.
That was the beginning of the end for Mr. Everman.
Yep, unfortunately.
Yeah, because apparently they went all the way up to New York.
Yep.
And then, well, tensions were getting really high between mostly Jason and Kurt and Chris.
Yep.
And one night, Kurt and Chris got drunk and did some drugs, I think, and then decided to kick out Jason.
Yep.
But also forgot to tell him.
Which is, yeah.
Yeah. And the story is that they drove back to Olympia or Seattle, all the way from New York.
Yep.
And during the drive back home, nobody said a word.
Which is really
awkward.
Awkward. Was that also when they canceled the last
yeah.
couple of gigs, right?
Yeah, I believe they were supposed to have some gigs in Canada even.
Yeah.
But they canceled them.
They
yeah.
they canceled the final leg of that tour because of their problems. And I think that Kurt also had some stomach problems around that time
yeah.
already. But they did. They had to come back later for those dates.
Yeah, that's possible.
Yeah, so they did them later on, but without Jason.
Yeah.
And there's also this story about how that last show in New York was pretty horrible because of the tensions and
yeah.
whatever. But apparently they had Iggy Pop in the audience. That would be sad for them to do like a really lousy gig, but then have one of their heroes be there.
Yeah. Well, from what I've heard of it, most of those gigs were pretty lousy. So,
true.
You know.
Yeah.
It wasn't like, oh, they had a massive streak of great performances and then
no.
one night they sucked and that was the night when Iggy Pop came
no,
to see
no,
them.
That's true.
And maybe Iggy liked what he saw, even
yep.
though it
could,
wasn't that good.
Could definitely be. And we don't know how Iggy himself was feeling while he was in the audience. I mean.
True. Yeah. So they went back home.
Yep.
Jason Everman was, well, in the end, he found out that he was out of the band.
Yep.
Bit of a sad story, because after that he joined Soundgarden.
Yep.
As a bassist, I believe.
Yeah, I think so.
But he was kicked out of Soundgarden as well before
they made it big.
Before they
yep.
made it big. And after that, I believe he had a pretty successful career in the military.
Oh,
went
I
to
didn't
Afghanistan.
Know that. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I think he did really well in a completely different field,
right.
so to speak.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So he found the discipline in the military instead of in touring
yeah.
with a band. Wow.
I guess so. It's an interesting
yeah.
interesting figure. And Nirvana, I think they tried out one guy as a fourth guitar player, a friend
mm-hmm.
of them, but then decided not to.
No.
take him on, and so they stayed a three-piece for the next couple of years.
I think that was probably a good idea at that moment, because there were still tensions between them as well, and everybody had their own little problems. So not getting another new person in there was probably the right decision. It might have been, I mean, the ideas about the sound that they had, I think actually, especially later on with the new songs, that wasn't that big of a problem anymore. And I think also that maybe when they decided to stay as a three-piece and had that experience in touring, that Kurt probably had that in mind when writing new songs as well.
Yeah, so yeah, possibly. And I think it was very clear that this was Kurt's band.
Exactly.
And Chris was on for the ride and supported him and probably came up with some stuff. But Kurt was like the creative force behind it. I've read in the Everett True book, by the way, that when they tried out the possible fourth member, that he asked him, would you be okay if we never play any of your songs because we're only going to play my songs?
Right. Yeah.
So it was pretty clear. Yep. Even I think even with Jason, that Kurt did all the solos and stuff. So it was really a role in the shadows if you would be the fourth member. So they went back home. Then something what I think is pretty interesting happened is that they started to collaborate with other people.
Yep. I think we mentioned, for instance, the Lead Belly recordings already, which they did around this period.
Yeah, it was Mark Langan from The Screaming Trees.
Yep.
And their drummer, whose name I don't know by heart at the moment.
I forgot it as well.
And
sorry,
Chris
drummer.
And Kurt, yeah.
Yep.
Let's listen to some of that stuff.
Yep.
We've already listened in the first episode to Ain't It a Shame, and they hung him on a cross. So let's listen to A Grey Goose now.
Sometimes it's like, I wish they'd like stayed together, the four of them, because
The Jury.
Oh yeah, The Jury was the name of the concept band. But for me, this works so well, and I would have loved to hear more material by them, because it's not.
Although I must say, Grey Goose isn't that good. I think
it's not that good, but I think that
there's something in there.
Yeah, there's something in there, and it's. It sounds like there's a lot of interesting creative things going on with them, and also the sound of all of the instruments and the singing on the other song is like, it really fits together.
Yeah.
I would have loved to hear more of that combination.
Yeah, true. But at least we got four tracks out of it, so that's cool. Also, Kurt was asked as a guest member on the Go team, which was a project by Toby Vale and Calvin Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
Who was the founder of K Records?
Yep,
which was a record label from the area. Fun fact: Kurt had only one tattoo, which was the letter K on a shield, which was the logo of K Records.
Wow. You know that? No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, because I believe he said that he wanted something to remind him to stay a childlike, something like that.
Okay.
To keep in touch with his inner child. I don't know, but that's the tattoo that he had. So.
Well, it's a K, which is also his first letter, so.
Yeah.
Sort of makes sense, I guess.
kind of.
Then again, tattoos not always make sense.
That's also true. Yeah. Calvin Johnson was a pretty big influence on him, because I think he also introduced him to the Vaselines. They covered a lot of Vaseline songs, and I think it helped Kurt to write more melodic songs and, you know,
definitely
drift away from the metal sounding, Melvin sounding stuff. And
yeah, definitely. And I think that it must have also secured him in his feelings about that, because the Melvins were a big influence on him and lots of other bands as well. But he tend to listen a lot to what local bands did and try to fit in there. And I think having local people to work with who can also promote other styles, that was something that he definitely needed, because we know he already had that melodic side in him. And having other people, like his peers, telling him, oh yeah, I like that as well, and did you know this band and whatever, I think that really helped him in feeling more secure about that side of his interest and songwriting.
Yeah. So want to have a listen to what he did with the Go Team?
Yes.
So it's up to you. Do you want to listen to Scratch It Out or Bikini Twilight?
Bikini Twilight.
Okay, yes. Here we go. So again, I don't think this is the best song I've ever heard, but it is interesting because it shows that Kurt was doing other stuff as well, and you can hear this being an influence on what he did with Nirvana later on.
Yeah, and I also think, I mean, I have no idea how this all came to be and where that title came from, but for me, like, the sound of this song, and that's why I chose it, is because it's it has that 60s California sound that you can also hear in the original of Love Bus, which is also a 60s song that has that melodic side to it. And this one especially, maybe it's my imagination, but because it's also called Bikini Twilight, I have this like Beach Boys with more guitars feeling to it.
Yeah.
For some reason, it feels like that kind of influence, which I find interesting.
Yeah. And drumming for the Go Team and also singing for the Go Team was Toby Vail, who would later become Kurt's girlfriend for a couple of months.
Yep.
So we go to the third collaboration that Kurt Cobain did, which was with the band Earth.
Yeah, it was a band, but it was an idea by Dylan Carson, who was a friend of Kurt. He was an old roommate. He was also the guy who provided him with the shotgun at the end of his life.
Yeah.
So that's his
claim to fame.
Claim to fame.
That's really dark.
That's
sorry, Dylan.
Yeah, because that's fortunately, that's not the only thing he did, because he's had a big career in music, not big as in that many people know him, but he's made a lot of records ever since and done a lot of music work. And this project, this Earth that he started, was something that they called it Drone Doom, which is basically a combination of doom metal and drone music. And drone music is a sort of minimal music that is based on a droning sound, which is like one tone that you keep hearing throughout an entire song. And to illustrate that, I think we should listen to it so you get what I mean.
Oh, I could listen to that all day.
Well, the interesting thing about the droning thing is that it's actually really old already. In medieval times, they did songs with just the drone and then people singing over that. So it's actually quite traditional, I'd say.
Okay.
it's a shame that like the vocals are so back in the mix in this one. They're almost inaudible, which I think is a shame, because that gives it a bit of texture. And that's also where we hear Kurt singing, but it's hard to hear.
Yeah. And I think it's pretty cool to note that, you know, the new sound of Nirvana would be somewhere in between the Go Team and Earth.
Exactly.
With a little bit of metal and screaming and weirdness, but also some melodics and some pop sensibilities. And maybe also a little bit of the Jury, you know, with a little bit of blues feel.
Yeah.
If you put those in a mix, when you kind of see where they were coming from.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that doing all of those collaborations with other people and having that studio time, which was new to Kurt as well, and having that label being a bit more known and having those other friends and colleagues that were getting those record deals as well, meant that they had more studio time, and being able to not just rehearse stuff but also record it and hear what it sounds like when you do it like that. I think that that has been a major influence on not just the new songs he was writing, but just his musicianship as a whole, having that experience.
Yeah, you may be right. Towards the end of the summer, Nirvana was getting back together in the studio.
Yep.
Because they did some recording sessions for an EP that was to be released, which would later be called the Blue EP.
Yeah.
And they didn't all end up on that EP, but they tried out some new songs that Kurt wrote.
Yeah.
Two of them we're going to have a listen to. First, a Token Eastern song. Okay, I want to hold it right there. I mean, that's kind of like the intro of Do You Love Me, don't you think?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so here's Do You Love Me. And here's Token Eastern song. Back in the day, I had a bootleg album with this song on it, but it was called Junkyard. So for a long time, I thought this song was called Junkyard.
Yep.
It's a weird name, Token Eastern song.
Yeah, this is probably another one of those, oh, we don't have a title, what's this? Oh, it's the Token Eastern song.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think that every album has like a Token Eastern song there, but it's sort of... And it doesn't sound Eastern, but I think that's
a
joke,
it's
probably.
It's a weird title, yeah. So on to the next one, Even in Its Youth. Later record this song again, and it would be a B-side of one of the Nevermind singles.
Yep.
I don't know which one.
No, can't remember.
We'll
get to that.
Yeah, we'll get to that later. But it's I kind of like this song.
Yep.
You can really hear Kurt's new songwriting style.
I think both of them are like like if you were to do like a movie or maybe a commercial and you wanted to have like a Nirvana song but you couldn't get it because of rights, mm-hmm. and you'd go to a composer and say like I need a Nirvana like song, then both of these would be like, you hear it's Nirvana, but they're close to their form. It's like they're 90% there,
yeah,
and they're just missing that final 10% that makes it like perfect vintage Nirvana.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, well, I must say personally, I really like Even in His Youth.
Yeah.
So that's what they did. They recorded a bunch of songs for an EP that would come out by the end of the year.
Yeah. And it's a bit of a weird story, I think. I think we talked before about how what they recorded and what was released wasn't always, it didn't feel logical. The EP was supposed to be for the UK and European market, I think.
Yeah, to promote their upcoming tour. But it was released after the tour was already finished.
But I think it was released so late because nobody really thought it was a good idea. It didn't really make sense, especially because those UK journalists had already been to the US and already knew about Nirvana, and they knew the album because the album had Bleach had already
finally been released. Yeah, that summer in June.
So having that extra EP wouldn't have made that much sense because they had to like sell Bleach
a brand
first.
New album.
Yeah, exactly. So it
don't know what happened there. Somebody came up with the idea to do a recording session and make an EP.
Yep.
And
yep.
I don't know if it was the record label guys or maybe the band.
I think it was the record label who wanted to do it. Yeah.
Yeah, but still, it's nice that we have these recordings.
Yep.
And then, like you said, they took off for their first European tour.
Yes.
So they flew to the UK.
Yep.
And they were quite popular there already.
Yes.
Thanks to mostly the idea of the Sub Pop guys to fly in a British journalist, Everett True, who was a writer for Melody Maker,
yeah, which was one of the biggest magazines in the UK.
Really started up the hype, not just around Nirvana, but also Mudhoney, Soundgarden. Yeah.
And the whole grunge thing, which was a really good idea by the Sub Pop guys to
really
brand it grunge. It's interesting how that took off because I can remember that vividly from that time, that the whole like there's something new and it's called grunge was really like you didn't really know what it was, but you knew it was something with guitars and whatever, so it sort of felt like interesting, and it was from the US. So as a European, remember everyone, this was before the internet. So
ancient history.
So getting that through like reading the music magazines and listening to the radio, and also MTV, which was getting popular in Europe around that time. That also paid attention to that whole, oh, there's something new from America and it's called grunge. That really paid off. And especially in the UK, where the music journalists really like labels and hypes like that, they really love like jumping onto the next
big thing. Yeah.
So that was like a masterpiece from Sub Pop to do that. And that definitely paid off.
Yeah.
That was really good. And also I think that the interesting thing is, I mean, later on, I know that Kurt was annoyed by that whole grunge thing.
Yeah, everybody was.
Everybody was eventually. And I think that there's no real definition, I think, about what grunge is. Sometimes it's like, oh, everybody who comes from that northwestern area. Sometimes it's like everything with heavy guitars from the late 80s and the 90s.
Yeah.
I saw a Rolling Stone magazine who did this year a list of like the 50 best grunge albums ever. And there was stuff in there that I was like, let me check. I wrote something down. they had like the Stooges are in there, like the Iggy Pop band, which is, well, they predate grunge. They were an influence in grunge. So it's like, but Neil Young is in there as well, which I think is really stretching it.
Yeah, well, he was, you know, he, personally, I really like Neil Young.
Yeah, me too.
And
me too.
He has some, you know, albums and live albums as well, which sound a bit grungy, like a garage, really dirty guitar sound.
True.
Also, he later said in an interview that he always wanted to talk to Kurt.
Yep.
And tell him that he didn't need to do anything. And he later bonded with the guys from Pearl Jam.
Yep.
They performed together.
Yeah, they performed together.
And I think Eddie Vedder, the singer of Pearl Jam, later said that he was really happy to find somebody who could lead by example.
Yeah.
I mean, because Neil Young does whatever he wants to do.
Exactly.
And if he has just made a really successful record, then he doesn't feel pressured to make another one like that.
Yeah.
If he wants to do something completely different, then he goes out and do something completely different. So in a way, I get it because of, you know, the more or less grungy guitar sound and the fact that he was associated with some of these people. But it's true that grunge is like an empty term.
And also, is it about the music? Or is it about the area? Or is it about the attitude?
Yeah.
Because they're like later
the
on, the image. Later on, we got like, I think 92 or something like that. There was that movie.
The Year Punk Broke?
No. The fiction movie with Matt Dillon.
Oh, yeah.
Something with an S. I forgot.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, probably...
With all the grunge bands except for Nirvana on it.
Exactly. Yeah. We'll probably mention it sometime later because there were so many bands in there. But
go to our Facebook page and we'll tell you what movie we're talking about.
But that was also, that was like more of like the image part of the grunge, like wearing those
flannel shirts.
Exactly. And, but interesting thing about that Rolling Stone best grunge albums, they also listed the Fecal Matter demo in there, which found really good.
Yeah, cool. Because because it's musically it's not that good.
No, but it's, I mean, they I think they chose the most important things. So that makes sense to have that in there because it's one of the birth moments of whatever you want to call grunge.
Yeah, that's true.
Anyway, back to
the UK, because Nirvana arrived and like I said, they drew kind of big crowds, several hundreds of people showed up for their gigs, like I said, mostly because they had some press already, other bands that were label mates of them had been there before as well, so that worked out pretty well, and I think that's also the reason why they were invited to do a session at the BBC's, a John Peel session.
Yep, and which is if you do a John Peel session, that's always really good publicity because that's like an entity on its own.
And they showed up there and they played pretty good, I think.
Yep.
And one of the songs they played was a new song they had, or actually they had it lying around for some time.
Yep.
Polly is the one I'm talking about. I've read somewhere that Kurt had already written it before they started to record Bleach, but he was afraid to put it on there because they already had About a Girl as like a more pop sounding song. Anyway, they did decide to play it for the BBC session. So here's Polly. She called me off my guard.
You played that part. Harmonies!
I know. I know you always want to hear harmonies. Yeah. And, well, you know, they were smart enough that when they went to those sessions that they played their more commercial songs, like this one, like Polly, like Love Buzz. I think they did About a Girl. So they knew what they were doing and when they had to show this side of them.
Yeah, definitely. And it also, it sounds really good. I mean, Polly is still, you can hear it's still sort of early days for this song, but like the clean sound of it really pays off for a radio show.
And for the rest of, I don't want to talk to about Polly too much because we're also going to discuss Nevermind and Incesticide and Unplugged in New York.
Exactly.
And they all have Polly on them. So we're going to fast forward a little bit. Also, I'd like to propose to fast forward the UK part of the tour. A lot of interesting stuff happened, but I don't want to dive too much into that. Because next up is Holland.
Yes.
And we're Dutch, so we're chauvinistic. And we want to talk about that a little bit.
They had quite a lot of dates in the Netherlands, which I find really interesting. I think 5, 6, something like that. Which is interesting for the small country that we are. We are a country that has a nice tradition in going to see bands live. We have a great infrastructure of lovely places to play. But for a band that was still virtually unknown, it's a big tour.
Yeah, absolutely. So they went to the Netherlands at the beginning of November, I think November 1st.
Yep.
Their arrival didn't go too well.
Nope.
Because Chris got really drunk. He drowned a bottle of whiskey. I believe on the way to the hotel, he started shouting at some local policemen.
Oh, wow.
Well, yeah, I believe the story is that they stood behind a police car while waiting for a traffic light.
Okay.
But the police car didn't have its lights on. And so Chris started shouting at him, turn your lights on, you. Something like that. Luckily, we also have a pretty relaxed police force. So they didn't get into trouble for that.
Nope.
He did get into trouble that when he arrived at the hotel, he started shouting at the manager of the hotel because he thought he looked like Freddie Mercury and he called him, let's say, the other F word.
Yes.
And so they got kicked out of the hotel the very very first night.
Which is interesting because it's an hotel that would often have bands there, so
you would say they were used to something, but they weren't used to a drunken Chris Novoselic. So that wasn't the best start, and it wasn't the best.
But Chris apologized the next day on the radio,
which is
really nice of him.
I think because in the Netherlands as well, they were invited to do like a session.
Yep.
For the VPRO radio show Nozems A Go-Go.
Yep, and that was presented by a Dutch presenter called Lotje IJzermans.
That went really fast. What's her name?
Lotje IJzermans.
Right.
Yes. female presenter who was early on was interested already in Nirvana, and she decided to get them into the studio because she was really interested in them. I read a recent interview with her that she in which she reminisced about how that worked and how she loved that part of her job, being able to get those people into the studio, and that they were really nice, and that she was sad to see when she eventually went to see them in the Paradiso that there weren't that many people to see them live, because she was like, I was hoping to get more.
You probably mean when she went to see them in the Melkweg.
Oh, Melkweg, sorry.
Not the Paradiso, that was later.
That was later.
Yeah, so we have a studio session from the Netherlands as well.
Yep.
Let's have a listen to that.
For somebody with a hangover, that bass playing sounds pretty good.
Yeah, so he made up.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they played heavier stuff they did for the BBC.
I think they must have been informed quite well about what sort of radio shows they were going to be at, because for this radio show it made total sense to play more heavy stuff, because they played even weirder and heavier stuff than this on that show.
Yeah. And for those of you keeping track, this was a song called Dive, which we talked about earlier, but without Jason Everman, the guitar player. So that same night, they went to Rotterdam, to a night town. In the pre-sale, about 5 tickets were sold. The owner offered them to cancel the show. They said, well, you're going to have to pay us anyway, so let's play. In the end, about 66 paying customers showed up, and they got to see a pretty okay show. I wasn't there. I was 8 years old at the time and had never heard of Nirvana.
I wasn't there either, but I did hear them play on the radio then.
Really?
Yeah.
Like live?
Yeah. Wow, yeah. I even recorded it on a cassette tape, which is now totally broken, so I don't have it anymore, but I had that. Yeah.
Wow, that's pretty cool. So they started off, quite okay with the Rotterdam show. It was received pretty well.
Yep.
I mean, it wasn't a big thing. I mean, 66 people went to see it, so what are we talking about? But still, there's an audio recording of it. And we're going to have a listen to Being a Son. Another new song that Kurt wrote around this period. Again, you can hear in which direction he was going. So those 66 people, I hope they had a good night. Next day, they went to Groningen, which is the city that I went to college, and I lived there for about 5 or 6 years. So that's always good to see that name come up.
All the way up in the north of the Netherlands.
All the way up the north, yeah. If you look at their the way they went across the country, it doesn't make a lot of sense.
No, and the rest of Europe, not really either, because they went to Germany, but later on they came back to Belgium. It's not that logical.
No, it must have been tough on them. I mean, they were crammed in a van together. Being on the road, not having a lot of money to spend, playing show after show. I mean, they had never done this many shows.
No, and I think, I mean, there's also a culture shock when you go from the USA to Europe. Maybe less so for Chris, because he'd been a bit more to his family's home country. But also then going to different countries in a couple of days, that's bound to be...
With at that time, different currencies.
Yep.
And, well, like it is today, different languages. But
exactly.
It must have been tough. And also that we're touring together, we haven't mentioned that, with the band called Ted.
Yep.
It was the Heavier Than Heaven tour.
Yep.
And I think that referred to both their heavy sound as the weight of the frontman of Ted, a guy called Ted, who was really, really big guy.
Yep.
I think the most legendary story from it is that he had a lot of stomach problems. So he had to throw up every day. And for some reason, Kurt was really keen on holding his bucket. So apparently for him, it was like the highlight of the day when Ted started to throw up.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting. interesting thing also, I think, about Ted, because they've kind of disappeared into the unknown, even though they broke up and they came back together, I think. But they haven't made it that big, so most people don't know them. But what I found really interesting is that I think that Tad was slightly ahead of Nirvana in their recording, because they recorded, like when they came back from this tour, they recorded a new album, which was produced by Steve Albini.
Oh, wow.
I didn't know that. Who later on did In Utero. And then the year after that, they recorded a new album, which was produced by...
Butch Vig?
Yes.
Really? Oh, I didn't know that.
So that I found that really interesting.
It is, yeah.
Yep.
Maybe the fact that Tad didn't make it big had something to do with the fact that at one point, after Nirvana became one of the biggest bands in the world, they were supposed to go on tour with them again.
Mm-hmm.
But then Tad, the guy, said something nasty about Courtney Love, who was Kurt's wife at that time, and so Kurt didn't want him on. So he kicked him out of the tour. And I think touring with Nirvana in those days was a really big opportunity.
Yes, definitely. Yeah, that's a shame.
Yeah, so that's bad luck for Tad. But you're right. I think at this point, from pretty much every interview I've read with people who went to see the tour, they most of them said that they liked Tad better than Nirvana.
Right, interesting.
Yeah, I know there's a documentary being made about Nirvana in the Netherlands.
Mm-hmm.
There's an interview with the guy from Groningen.
Yep.
Who booked him, or was the owner of the place, or the manager, I don't know. And he wrote a review of it, and he said that he liked Tad a lot better.
Wow.
And that losing the fourth guitar player put a lot of pressure on Kurt Cobain, as he wrote. So, but yeah, they did a gig in Groningen, 92 visitors, at least that's what I've...
Going up.
Going up, and also... going down 2 days later. Yeah, and another factoid I've read is that Kurt apparently threw up in front of a student's faculty that night.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Because let's not forget, Tad had stomach problems, but Kurt had health problems as well.
Definitely, and I think before they went to Europe, he had like extensive hospital visits because of his stomach problems. So that was really a factor that started weighing in during this period. So
yeah, and also he was on a diet of junk food and candy.
And exactly, and being on tour isn't healthy either, because you don't have really time to eat properly because you're constantly traveling or rehearsing or playing or whatever. So that must have been bad for his condition as well.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody noted that when they got a pizza for the guys, that Kurt took everything off.
Wow. Yeah.
Just ate like the bottom of it. So after Groningen, they went to Utrecht. Still going up. 125 people showed up at the Tivoli. I was there quite recently. They have a picture of Kurt somewhere.
Oh, nice.
On the inside now.
See that.
After that, November 4th, they went to... Apeldoorn.
Mm-hmm.
And that was probably the worst show. They played for only 30 minutes and then they were so frustrated, it was horrible, and they decided to trash their gear. I mean, they did stuff like that before, but this time they really
really trashed it.
Really trashed it.
To be honest, Apeldoorn isn't the spot you would expect the biggest Nirvana audience to be.
No, that's... Yeah, maybe not, maybe not. But they went on destroying things in the dressing room. I've read somewhere that they broke a vase and then Kurt put the flowers in his pants. So just to give you a little impression. After that, their tour manager, Edwin Heath, he had a good conversation with them that they had to better their ways. And they kind of did, because they... closed off their tour in the Netherlands,
mm-hmm.
or the Dutch part of their tour in Amsterdam.
Yes.
With a show at the Melkweg, in which your cousin wasn't, you just said.
Exactly. My cousin, which I mentioned in the first episode, because he introduced me to Nirvana. He wanted to get to that show, but he didn't have any money. So he tried to sneak in, but it didn't work.
No, and it probably didn't work because, again, not a lot of people showed up. So it's exactly. Pretty hard to sneak in.
Definitely.
Yeah, but still, there were about around 200 people. Official, talking about official documents, one more detail about the Apeldoorn show.
Right. Yeah, that's the next one.
Yeah, the contract is missing. They tried to look it up, I think, for the documentary.
Right.
No, maybe they still had it in the documentary, and after that it disappeared.
Okay.
So somebody stole that contract on which Kurt wrote his name and probably signed an autograph.
Yep.
So
Makes sense to nick it.
Yeah, it's probably worth... a lot more than they got paid for.
So if you're listening and you have that contract like hanging on your wall, send us a picture. We won't tell everyone your name, but just send it to us.
Or if you don't want to send us a picture, just send a contract and we'll make a picture of it.
That's fine as well.
Ourselves. back to the last show they did in the Netherlands, Amsterdam gig. They ended that show with a version of Vendetta Against. You can really hear their pop sensibilities come through now. No, it was a total noise track. After the Netherlands, they went on to Germany, Hungary, Austria, and then to Italy.
Yes.
By the way, if you want to follow this tour, you can turn to Twitter. We're just a little bit late with this podcast show, actually, because there's this hashtag Nirvana Euro 30. In which they follow the entire tour. So you can see day by day where they were playing, see some pictures of it. They also ask for memorabilia. Wow, that's a tough word to say. And footage from it.
Yeah.
I think it's initiative of livenirvana.com, which is a great source of information about stuff like this.
Yeah, and the nice thing is that there's some stuff in there, if you look at that hashtag, that is really new or newish, or at least stuff that isn't easily available in other sources. So it's really nice to see those extra things there.
That's right. One of the things that recently turned up is a show from Italy, in which Kurt joined Ted and actually sang a few of their songs. So let's have a listen to a bit of Ted featuring Kurt Cobain. Yeah, that was Wood Goblins.
Yes, if you were wondering what they were shouting, that was Wood Goblins.
Yeah, you can listen to the entire performance on YouTube.
Yep.
There's no video footage, but somebody threw in some pictures of the guy, so that gives you a nice impression. Then the tour ended in Italy, in Rome. On a very on a bit of a sad note, I think, because the stress of and the tough touring life was really taking a toll on Kurt. The guys from Sub Pop, they flew in. I think they said it was probably to support them.
Yeah.
But it kind of yeah, made a bad impression because, like we said, they were crammed in a van for a month with not a lot of money to spend, bad food, gig after gig after gig after gig after gig.
Exactly.
And then these record company guys, the big cheese, comes and flies in with an airplane just to say hi.
Yep.
Well, yeah, so their good intentions kind of backfired.
Yep, I think so. And Kurt decided to quit the band.
Yeah, everybody decided to quit the
yeah,
band.
Yeah, but first Kurt decided to quit the band. And then, yeah, the others did as well.
Yeah, because without Kurt, there wouldn't be a band anyway.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And apparently when Kurt said he'd quit the band, then I think the Sub Pop guys did say to him, well, we would be interested in you as a solo artist as well.
Really? Oh.
Yeah, that's at least what I read. But I think it all went pretty quickly because Kurt said I'm quitting, and then the others quit as well, and then, well, they might as well just continue.
yeah well, I think what happened is he was really fed up with it.
Yeah.
He was probably not feeling well because of all of the pressure.
Exactly.
And the horrible tour schedule, homesick as well, maybe.
Yep.
There's records that he sent a lot of postcards to his girlfriend.
Yep.
Tracy Miranda. He was having his health problems. So, it almost entirely broke down that,
yep,
that night.
Yep.
And, you can kind of hear it during the show because, it ended like this. Yeah, so they cut short a spank through. I think Kurt,
yep,
made a mistake and something, had some technical problems with,
yep,
his guitar.
Again,
and,
yeah,
he ran off. He climbed on top of a stack of amplifiers and threatened to jump off.
Yep.
One source says that the crowd started to roar, jump, jump. other sources say that everybody was really shocked by it and he was going crazy, basically.
Yep. Like you say, a sad ending to the tour. Thankfully, it didn't end the band.
No.
But it makes sense after that whole year. I mean, what's this? Like end of November, I think? Something like that? Beginning of December?
Yeah, that's right.
And they started touring in the US in February. So that must have been exhausting. I think they did about 100 gigs. So
yeah, over 100 gigs,
yeah,
I think, one year. Yeah.
In about 300 days. So yeah, that's
yeah,
a lot.
Yeah. If you want to get more of an impression of these days in the career of Nirvana, Mr. Bruce Pavitt from a Sub Pop label, he also published a book.
Oh, right, yeah.
He took a lot of photographs.
Yeah.
And collected them in a book. I think it came out a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
I must say, I haven't seen it. I've seen pictures from it, but I don't own the book. So
I don't own it either, but I've seen it. I've flicked through it, and it's. I think it's really interesting if you're into that sort of like photo books, then this is really a nice one because,
yeah,
it gives a really interesting look behind the scenes and candid moments. And it's nice.
Yeah. And so the next day after everybody basically quit the band and Kurt had a breakdown, they had to patch things up.
Yep.
So they went walking through London, Rome.
Rome.
So they went to the Colosseum, I think.
Yep.
And Kurt was promised a new guitar to please him a little bit, something like that.
Yeah, probably.
And then, you know, they got together again, or they decided to stay together.
Yeah.
Depends on how you look at it. Right in time, because the most important gig from the tour was coming up. So they did a couple more shows before they went back to the UK.
Yep.
To perform in London at some sort of a showcase event.
Yep.
It was called the Lame Fest.
Lame Fest, yeah.
Yeah, Sub Pop organized several nights under the title of Lame Fest.
Yep.
It was like I said, like a showcase of their bands.
Exactly, they did that in the US already, and it had been quite successful. I think they did it like somewhere in June already in the US, and they had like Tad and Mudhoney there as well, and again, Sub Pop was really good at marketing, and that whole idea of calling it Lame Fest really attracted the crowd. Yeah. Apparently they had like t-shirts that said loser on it, and they sold really well, and so it connected with people.
Yeah.
So that was a good idea.
Yeah, and not only were there a lot of fans, there were also a lot of executives from record companies.
Yes.
And important people from the music industry.
Yep.
Well, Nirvana came on. They had technical difficulties in the first song. I believe Kurt broke a string or something like that.
Yeah, I think so.
So yep. The second song is them jamming on a Wanna Be Your Dog. Let's listen to that.
I like hearing this. I also like how you hear somebody in the crowd laughing. But it has sort of that, I think we talked before about like Sex Pistols and stuff like that, which were like the quintessential British punk band, and this sort of appeals to that feel a bit, so I can see how this would sort of work.
Yeah. But I can also see how it wouldn't really impress the hotshots from the music industry.
No.
But what happened after that is pretty remarkable, I think, because again, some sources say that Nirvana totally rocked it and they were a big success.
Yep.
Other sources say that they totally sucked, like the drummer from Mudhoney,
yep.
Dan Peters. He said that it was a disaster. But yeah. Again, I wasn't there. It's hard to judge. I do know that this was a very important night in their career because
yes.
they did attract attention from other record labels and stuff. So they must have done something right.
Yep. Yeah, definitely. It must have been interesting at least.
Yeah. Yeah. And they played some of their new stuff as well. I want to end this podcast with a short listen to one of their new songs, which most people will know as Breed, because it's on the very well-known Nevermind album.
Yes.
Back in the days, it was still called Imodium.
Oh, yeah, right.
After
true.
An anti-diarrhea
yes.
substance that Ted Doyle took. But I think it's cool to see that they already worked in some Nevermind material.
Yep.
Into their set, and maybe that's also something that attracted the attention and interest of other record labels.
Yep.
So here's Breed / Imodium as it sounded on that night. What do you think? If you were a big record company executive, would you think, oh, I have to sign that band?
Well, I mean, it's hard to say in hindsight because like you know the song.
Yeah.
So hearing it like this now and like I'm enjoying this version, but that could also be because I already know the
yeah.
song. But if at least if you listen to it like carefully, you can hear that they play it well. And it sounds different from some of the other bands and some of the other stuff. I think the bass is not as clear, but that could be the recording. You don't know how
yeah.
that sounded when you were there, because that's one of the standout things, I think, in this song that makes it different from other songs. But
yeah, and the pure energy that they
exactly.
have. Exactly. Yeah. Okay, so I think that's mostly it for 1989.
Yes.
Except for the fact that on the very last day, is that what you were going to say?
Go ahead.
Okay, yes. Krisztina Forselli got married.
Exactly, I thought let's end on a really nice, positive fairy tale note.
Yeah, he got married to his girlfriend Shelley Dilly.
Yes.
With whom he had been together for a long time.
Yep.
They've been apart for a while as well, but they got back together, and on New Year's Eve they got married. So that's a nice ending, I think, for this episode.
Yep.
So I want to thank you for joining me once again to talk about Nirvana.
Yes, thank you for having me.
And I want to thank everybody out there listening, and I also want to thank Joep Hillegie from Piano Nirvana for did I say it right?
Other way around.
Nirvana Piano for providing our theme music.
Yes.
So if you like what you're hearing, please subscribe and rate and review and do whatever you can to support us. And we will talk to you next time. Bye.
Goodbye.